My presentation is going to have a strong focus on science and education for the SDGs, okay? So the emphasis will be on science and education in the context of the SDGs. So I'd like to start with a question, and there will be a few questions coming along in the next few minutes. And it would be more questions at the very end after I finish, which means that if you haven't paid attention, you may not be able to answer those questions. Be careful. Okay, so the first question is, when you look at these colorful graphics and icons, are you familiar with them? Do you know what you're looking at? Yes, raise your hand. I see nearly everyone is raising their hand, right? So you feel that you know what you're looking at, okay? Okay, so there are 17 goals. You're familiar with them. Good. However, you know that behind each goal, there are targets. There are 169 targets. So if I were to ask you, pick one of the goals, your favorite one, and tell me, what's your favorite target? What's your most meaningful target? These are the 169 targets. Who, raise your hand, who would be able now to speak out one of the targets? One hand is up. So that's my experiment succeeded. Some more, okay, but let's look at some targets because, you know, I really want to make my point. So let's start with one of the SDGs I think is really important, which is SDG number 4 about education. And here there are two targets. Let's look at these. The first one is, that should be very important to you, eliminate gender disparities in education. The second one, I really like the second one because it says ensure that all learners acquire the knowledge and skills needed to promote sustainable development. Because really, we talk about so much sustainable development, but actually most people don't even understand what sustainable development really means. So education is very important, which was in my title. Let's look at target 13. Actually, target 13, which is climate action, the goal 13, is one of the goals that has the least number of targets, even though it should be a very important goal, the climate. So anyway, this one says, build knowledge and capacity to meet climate change. Again, build knowledge and capacity links to education, formation, okay? So I'll come back to education because it's so important. And 12, do you know SDG number 12? Okay, here, SDG number 12 has these two targets I'm highlighting to you. Half per capita global food waste. Food waste is one of the largest contributors to unsustainable development, to greenhouse gas emissions, and therefore to climate change as well. And although I'm talking to you, you don't live in Europe. So I shouldn't be talking to you about this target because the largest amount of food waste is in North America, next is Europe. So it's a complete disaster. And then the other target I want to say, ensure that people everywhere have the relevant information and awareness. Again, this links to education. Because if you don't have the information, if you don't have the awareness, how can you work towards sustainable development? Again, we need to understand what that really means, okay? So I hope this little introduction has made the point that we generally, I'm being very general now, but we assume or think that we know what the SDGs are, but in fact, we don't really fully know because many of these targets, if you really look at these targets, they are very intelligent, they're very thoughtful, they're very profound. So looking at the colorful icons is not enough. The major issue, in my opinion, I want to provoke you and say the major issue that is hindering progress towards sustainable development is ignorance, which is why my title, again, of the talk has education in it. So let's do some more experiments to demonstrate if this is true or not. Another question for you. Let's look at this picture. And the question is, are you familiar with this number that refers to a limit? If you are not from Europe, but if you are from the UK, then we change the number to 30, okay? But the concept, the question is pretty much the same. So raise your hands if you're familiar with that. But I can see most people are raising their hands. Yes, most people, some people that don't drive, I understand, because this is a speed limit on the road. Now, here is another number. Same question, are you familiar with this limit? Raise your hands if you are. I see only three, four hands, three and a half, because this one is kind of half. So that again shows my point that most people were familiar with the previous limit, but very few people are familiar with this one. So sad, but so true. So in many, many workshops, I see the yes, a big yes here. A few people say no, those people that, you know, you shouldn't be on the road when they drive. And then over here is the opposite, but 350 parts per million refers to the safe limit of CO2 in the atmosphere. A limit that scientists worldwide published not yesterday, not last year, not 10 years ago, but it's been known for more than 15 years. It's been known globally. Sadly, if you're asking what is the current amount of CO2 in the atmosphere, well, we are between 415 and 420, which is way beyond 350. Perhaps that's why nobody cares about 350 anymore. But the point is that we seem to know a lot about this one. So there is familiar knowledge, and then there is, so there is common knowledge, I was saying, and there is common ignorance, okay? Remember that my point was about ignorance. I wanted to make a point about ignorance, yeah? No offense to anyone, by the way. Let's carry on, because we hear people talk a lot about CO2, yes? CO2 is a major greenhouse gas. How many of you do you hear people talk about another greenhouse gas? Raise your hand. Who hears a lot of people talk about methane? A lot of people. Do you hear a lot of people talk about methane? No, no, few, very few. You hear a lot of people talk about methane. Methane, yes, yeah. So not many people hear the methane story. It's a disaster. It's another example of common ignorance. Let me demonstrate it to you. If we compare methane and CO2, what we see is that the heat trapping ability of methane is much, much greater, because we need over 20 times less methane to trap the same amount of heat. So methane is over 20 times more powerful as a greenhouse gas, over 20 times. Do you understand what that implies? It implies that a small amount of methane will cause the same greenhouse effect as a lot of CO2, okay? Okay, cool. So what, you may say? There's a lot of CO2, not very much methane. Not true, there's a lot of methane. Methane emissions from cattle are 11% higher than estimated. Cows have more than one stomach. In one of their stomachs, called rumen, there is an anaerobic environment which enables the cow to digest pretty much anything it eats, anything natural, not plastic or things like that, obviously. As a result of the anaerobic digestion, a lot of methane is released. A cow, an average cow, can release between 300 and 500 liters of methane per day. That's one cow. It depends on the variety of cow, where it is, what kind of grasses it's eating, but between 300 and 500 liters of methane per day. In fact, this other article says that avoiding meat and dairy, do you understand the word dairy? Yeah, dairy is any cow product. Milk, cheese, things like that, is the single biggest way to reduce your impact on Earth. Okay, so the story of methane is an example of ignorance because people don't hear about this. Even if you read articles on COP, you know, the COP 27, there was COP 27 last November, there will be COP 28 later this year, etc. Okay, so this is a disaster. But if you look at this article in Nature, this is August 2019, it's not yesterday, it's not last year, August 2019. This was the first time ever that an intergovernmental organization, intergovernmental, so we step, finally, we step from science to government, from education and research to policy, for the first time ever, UN climate change report calls for a change to human diet. If you were to read this, it talks about dairy. Now, don't get me wrong, I was brought up on dairy. I've eaten probably more cheese than most of you put together. So it's not that I was born hating dairy, and so now I'm here talking badly about cows and dairy products, okay? But I'm just talking about the science, because if I'm a scientist and I look at the data, that is the data. It doesn't matter what my parents gave me. It doesn't matter what my tongue tells me when I put cheese in my mouth. The methane is still there, because that's the fact, the science. In fact, if we keep carry on and we look at data that is widely published, what we see is that cows and agriculture provide a larger contribution than even transportation to the greenhouse gas emissions. So again, this is probably not what you were thinking, because the knowledge is not sufficiently widespread and the ignorance is greater than the information, okay? If you look at the UN Environmental Program, this is the UN Environmental Program, again, they're really strongly promoting the new concept that we should rethink the way we eat. Very, very strong message. Later, after the Nature paper in 2019, the next year in 2020 in Science, this cornerstone publication, I read the title with you, said global food system emissions could preclude achieving the 1.5 and 2 degree climate change targets. If you look at the global food system emissions and read the paper, again, the methane story is strong and clear, the cow contribution, the dairy and all of that. Okay, so in conclusion, from that story, I think I'm making, again, my point of ignorance. But let's go to another question. Can you name the two people you see in this picture? You can name one of them, yes? Please tell me. I hear the name Greta. Greta, yeah? Can you also name Greta? Can you name none of them? So some people can name one of them, right? Some people seem to be able to name the young person here, yes? Some people. Can anyone name this gentleman? Okay, I tried not to take that too in an offensive way, because I'm not sure I feel that young myself. Well, I feel young, but perhaps I don't look so young. No social media presence. Well, I will try to fight your statement with my next slides. First of all, both of these people are Swedish. Both of them are Swedish. So what? Doesn't mean anything, right? Okay, let me talk more about the gentleman that looks old. Who is a chemist in the room? Raise your hand. Now, nobody's raising their hands, but before I heard some chemists. before I heard some chemists. So if you're a chemist in the room, you must be familiar with the Arrhenius equation. It's one of the most beautiful equations, not just in chemistry, but in science in general. Will you agree with me? So don't you feel sad that despite the beauty of this equation, you're not familiar with Arrhenius, Professor Svante Arrhenius, who got a Nobel Prize. You can name Greta, but you cannot name Arrhenius. Do you feel a sense of shame? I see. Okay, let me talk to the chemist then. Absolutely. Absolutely. Nevertheless, whether you're a physician or a biochemist, please never ever forget Professor Arrhenius and the Arrhenius equation, okay? Now, let's look a little bit more at Professor Arrhenius. You see here, Professor Svante Arrhenius, okay, wrote in 1896, I know it sounds a bit long time ago, doesn't make it boring because it's a long time ago, but he wrote in this journal, and let's read together this this title, On the Influence of Carbonic Acid in the Air. Carbonic acid in the air is CO2, okay? Upon the temperature of the ground. So this paper is about the greenhouse effect. If you were to read the paper, it even says, if we carry on the combustion of coal and other fossil fuel, the temperature of the atmosphere globally will rise and rise, which he thought at the time may not be so bad because he was from Sweden and it's cold in Sweden, okay? But my point is that in 1896, the greenhouse effect was clearly explained in this one paper, which you probably knew nothing about. But you will find this on social media if you really look hard. And Greta didn't quote this in social media when she makes all her theatrical performances. In fact, instead of being out of school, she better be in school studying this. She and every kid, because education is key. You see my point? Good. So now let's go 120 years after this paper, okay? 120 years after, you see, 2016, Nature Climate Change, and there is a new paper. I will argue with you that the conclusions of this paper are no different from Svante Arrhenius's paper. The only difference is that this paper uses a huge amount of data, uses models that are advanced and accurate. And it's a collaborative paper, but the juice of the story is pretty much the same, which is the effect, so the response, the effect on climate of releasing all that carbon is detrimental. The conclusion, the general conclusion is the same, okay? But between Svante Arrhenius in 1896 and these gentlemen and gentlewomen, gentlemen, gentlewomen, I've got to be careful here. In 2016, there are many, many, many scientists and a huge amount of research work, okay? I hope you appreciate that, right? Because your researchers, you know what it means to do research, how much work it is, how much commitment. And yet, when I show you this picture, you don't know who he is. And most people will know who she is. I find that deeply depressing, deeply disconcerting, because science is the reason why we can do most of what we do. Getting on a plane, using a smartphone, having a fridge, wearing glasses. These are all applications of scientific knowledge. And yet the society in general doesn't seem to appreciate that. So science and education are the key, I keep saying again. Now, One last example of ignorance. There is a group of scientists called the Union of Concerned Scientists, UCS. And in 1992, they published a little article, which was called World Scientist Warning to Humanity. It talked about the lack of sustainable development, the lack of sustainability in the path of growth globally. This statement was endorsed by over 1,500 scientists. And in that number, nearly 200 Nobel laureates were included as signatories. Did you know about this? But then, 25 years later, so 25 years after 1982, in another paper, World Scientists Warning to Humanity, a second notice. Why? 25 years later, they saw no progress whatsoever after their first warning. So they published a second one. But let me show you what happens in the second one. How many scientists are there? Yes. Just to reiterate my point before, when I said between Arrhenius and the Nature Climate Change paper, how many scientists were there? Well, now you get an idea of how many scientists just recently, and yet not many people are aware of these papers, of these warnings, okay? So in conclusion, I showed you five examples of any ignorance. The first one was the lack of knowledge on targets, on SDG targets, on particular targets, not all targets, not all 169, but at least for your particular SDG that you're interested in, you might or should know something about some of the targets. And then we looked at the limit of 350 parts per million, which is a scientific result. Then we looked at methane, more scientific data. And then we looked at Arrhenius, that you should know the Arrhenius equation for sure, but please know more than the Arrhenius equation. And then finally, we looked at the Union of Concerned Scientists warnings first and second. Five examples that tell us, and I'm including myself in you here because I am still learning. We are all still learning if we make an effort, obviously. Okay, fine. So let's move on from here, because what I want to say is go back to education for the SDGs. The power of education relies on the knowledge action nexus. Let's look at this for a second. We know that science can produce new knowledge. We know that education can convey and explain knowledge. Once you have this knowledge, you understand concepts, you can explain phenomena, you can address problems and issues. Once you understand, therefore, you can act. And if you act, there will be change. So I hope you are agreeing with me that without science and without education, which are the two starting points here, you're not going to get much change. That's why it's so important to be broad and to keep learning. The problem with science or research, and I know because I did almost 20 years of research in the area of protein structure and protein-protein interactions, it's very narrow. It's very focused. It's the nature of research to focus, okay? But we need to keep a broad perspective. What is missing from the knowledge action nexus is one important concept, which is something that is encompassed in this declaration of UNESCO. It's not even recent, it's 1997. I used to be young then. And the title of this declaration for that conference is Responsibilities of the Present Generation Towards Future Generations. There are two articles I really like: the preservation of life on Earth, again, for future generations, the protection of the environment, again, for the future generations. So the emphasis is on the future generations. But what is the emphasis is that we need to feel responsibility towards the future generation. So when I came in this morning, we were talking about sleeping, and I discovered that you don't have kids, but you do. Perhaps you're not feeling this responsibility yet, which is fine. But did you feel greater responsibility after something happened? Yes, I did as well. I have two kids. And I was very selfish as a human individual. I admit to you, so selfish. Especially when my parents were giving me so much, I just took it. Huh. But after having kids, suddenly I reevaluated even my parents, not just myself. So responsibility is not a far-fetched concept. We need to feel it. We need to feel it. Our actions have consequences. Our decisions have effects and aftermaths. And if we don't care about ourselves, we should care about the next generations. It's really important, in my opinion. It's an ethical issue, right? So let me take this forward, and the next few slides are going to be unpleasant. Please prepare yourself. Are going to be unpleasant, okay? Okay. All right. So the OST Early Career Fellows, a great honor to meet you. Great honor, great honor. Please, Dr. Bitalo, do not take offense, okay? Do not take offense, because here you are, this is your travel, okay? And you left your lovely country, you transit in Addis, then you landed in Rome. I hope your journey was okay, right? Painful, yeah, painful, painful, but now I'm gonna make it even more painful. So don't take any offense, I just picked a random participant, okay? I could have picked any of the others. But what you see is that if you insert this flight from Uganda Kampala to Rome via Addis, we get 1.9 tons of CO2 emissions associated with that flight. Because from Rome, you flew further to Trieste, I'm going to approximate to 2 tons. Allow me to approximate to 2 tons, okay? Yeah, you see at the bottom, I placed that there, 2 tons. But there are, how many are there of you? Unfortunately, Hazir couldn't be here. She's online. I hope you're still online, Hazir, and you haven't fallen asleep. I've been trying to keep people awake here, but anyway. So because there are 20 fellows, we get a total of 40 tons of CO2. Now imagine these billions of molecules flying out in the atmosphere. Imagine when you were traveling, it was painful, but now it's even more painful. You feel the pain, the responsibility, yes? Okay, so the point of this exercise is to feel the responsibility. Why? Because you may think, 40 tons, what is 40 tons anyway? What is 2 tons? Let me give you a real feeling for that. So 1 hectare of forest can capture between 4 and 6 tons of CO2 per year, photosynthesizing for 1 year, okay? Between 4 and 6, depending on the forest, depending if it's a temperate or subtropical, tropical, yeah, it depends, okay? Okay, so what we see, therefore, is that in order to capture 40 tons, we need about 10 hectares of forest photosynthesizing for 1 year. You may think, okay, 10 hectares, how much is it? Yeah, because it's the same story. 40 tons, what is it? 10 hectares. Well, we are now somewhere in the Adriatic guesthouse, facing the beautiful Adriatic Sea. Next door to us is a park of the Miramare Castle. All this green area that you see is just over 20 hectares. It's a large area, don't get me wrong, it's a large area. Tomorrow, I believe after lunch, we'll be walking in there. But don't think after you walk, no, it's not so large. No, because it's much larger than you think, and I bet we will not walk all over the place. Okay? So it's a large area. So about half of Miramare Park for synthesizing for 1 year will offset. But now, exactly this idea of offsetting has been used. If we had here our finance colleagues who purchased the tickets, right? They would tell us, don't worry, Max. Don't worry, host fellows. Take a chill pill. Everything is cool. Why? Because in 2020, this circular came from UNESCO, the internal carbon tax will be applied on air travel. What is the carbon tax? The carbon tax is an extra amount that you pay, and then that amount goes towards projects that offset those carbon emissions. And so we can feel our responsibility go off. Suddenly we feel cool again. Everything is hunky-dory. Sorry to ruin it for you, but this is rubbish. Unfortunately, I also believed for some time the carbon offsetting was amazing, but scientists have looked into this. They've looked at these claims of carbon neutrality, okay? Because you can say, like UNESCO here is saying, we do this, this is causing emissions, therefore we do that, that captures, so everything is okay. Even Shell says drive carbon neutral. So these claims are everywhere. That's why scientists have looked into this, because the claims have been spreading. More than 90% of rainforest carbon offset by biggest certifiers are worthless. And you can read more and more about this and look into the reasoning and the data. Yet, you go through an airport, you go through anywhere, and suddenly you see a beautiful picture of a nice natural environment, pristine and lovely, and it says 100% neutral. This is called greenwashing. Okay? Greenwashing. It's highly irresponsible. Thankfully, the EU, this was published in February 2023, so not very long ago, the EU is going to crack down on greenwashing with penalties. So finally, politicians and policymakers are thinking about this and taking action, because it's very, very serious. Ethically, it's so wrong. But I hope I'm getting the message to you that thinking about the SDGs and thinking about sustainable development is not just colorful icons. You need to go beyond that. You need to know, you need to learn, you need to reason, you need to analyze, you need to be responsible, you need to be ethical, okay? Sorry, I'm being very heavy now. I told you the next slides were gonna be a bit heavy. But ethical issues are indeed associated with climate change, and they are indeed associated with sustainable development in general. And these ethical issues are making the next point very difficult. Because the science policy dialogue is not working and is hindering progress towards sustainable development. And that dialogue is made even worse and even more difficult by the ethical issue, because there will be many governments, especially European governments or US government, so governments from certain countries, they want to turn a blind eye to certain ethical issues. Very complicated, very delicate, very bad. But again, another reason why you should know about this. You should know about this also because you're a scientist. So you are here in the science policy dialogue. Don't think, oh, well, that doesn't concern me because I'm in my lab. Feel involved. I'm not telling you to talk to the president of your country, but you can talk to your head of department. You can talk to the mayor of your city council. You can talk to the main politician of your region. But don't feel that your voice doesn't count. Once you empower yourself with knowledge and science, feel the strength, the lucidity, and the confidence to talk to the policymakers, because the science policy dialogue needs to be improved. There is a disconnect. This disconnect is one major problem with the progress. Because you may say, science has many solutions. I heard before about fermentation, and Hazir online, she works on biofuels and so on. So science can have many solutions, but these solutions are often not put into practice because politicians don't know, don't understand, or they look at different priorities, okay? But when I talk about this, the typical question is what you read here. What can I do as a single individual? You talk about policymakers, well, they have to do the thing. And I'm just a researcher. No, you're the future. You're not just a researcher. You could be the researcher of the year, of the world, of the, you know, so feel that power. Let's talk about what we can do as a single individual, each one of us, okay? So first of all, you can educate yourself, because no one can claim to know everything. Okay, I studied, I told you before, protein structure. Well, protein structure has got nothing to do with biodiversity. Perhaps I can do a course on biodiversity. Why? Well, because biodiversity is really important. My life relies on biodiversity. I'm part of a system. So perhaps I should understand something about that. It's just an example, okay? So never limit yourself to what is your specialism. Yes, you have expertise. But remember that being too narrow is not the solution to everything. The role of scientists, at least 4 points I want to make. This is your role. As an individual, yes. Keep an open mind and a wide perspective. I told you that before. Educate and communicate. Remember, you've got students. You can tell them beyond that particular course. You can be a role model, number three. Yeah, you've got brothers, sisters, cousins, you've got colleagues, you've got friends, you've got your community. You need to go beyond your specialism. Why? Because there is something called moral and social responsibility. Remember the word responsibility we need to feel, okay? So let's start by analyzing this graph in terms of keeping an open mind and a wider perspective, and also feeling the responsibility I was telling you about. So what you see here is a graph that depicts the relationship between the lifestyle and the energy being consumed. Of course, it is very true that in some of your countries, this will be very different from Europe, or even worse, the United States, or even worse, Oman or Dubai. But generally, the tendency is that as we were primitive to hunter-gatherer, to a more evolved or civilized, if that's the right word, we consume more and more energy, okay? So it does say in a developed country here, okay? Or in developed countries in general. And this is another thing that connects to the ethical issue I was mentioning before. I didn't go into it, but yeah, okay. So this is very important. It may not be so important to you, but still some of your countries are developing. And as a developing, the energy consumption is increasing. Why do we need to look at these systems with a wide perspective and a sense of responsibility and ethics? Because unfortunately, at least from a Western perspective, Western and developed country perspective, I'm talking about that because sadly I am from a so-called developed country or from a so-called Western world, okay? So I will claim that this is what in my society the view is. And this is very, very bad indeed. It's not just that the animals are worth nothing, but even the male individuals are of greater importance or greater power than female individuals. This is so incredibly wrong. So we need to change our perspective, okay, in a scientific way, because this is science. Science tells us that this is the reality, okay? So unfortunately, many of the things we do are influenced and dictated by an anthropocentric mentality, which established itself in the course of history, especially in Europe and beyond, okay? But this is not the right way. If we look at science, if we look at ecology, which I'm not an expert of, but again, it's where I'd like to learn more about. It's the ecocentric way that we need to promote. So I hope you I've convinced you that some of these points about the role of scientists, even at an individual level, are very, very worthwhile in the context of the SDGs, okay? I told you before that I used to study and do research in protein structure. I remember during those years, spotting this article in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. This is back in 2017. And it talks about the sixth mass extinction. I was like, oh, what's this? I started reading about it. Please realize that protein structure and this are like an elephant and an orange, are very different things, okay? So normally I would just read articles in my own field. But this shows you how important it is to look at articles in other fields, because this is highly, highly relevant to the SDG story that we are talking about and the anthropocentric view. The anthropocentric view is the reason why there is a sixth mass extinction going on. We could do a talk just on that topic, just a whole 45 minutes of discussion and talking on the sixth mass extinction. Now, if we go beyond that, quite a few years later in 2019, we see an interesting article that says high extinction risk for wild coffee species. Before, when I talked about heavy slides, unfortunately, I should have told you there was some other heavy slide, because now I've just ruined your coffee break. When you drink your coffee today and tomorrow in the future, you will think, the six-month extinction, whatever, Max. No, the six-month extinction also involves things that are very close to us. It's not just that rhino somewhere in a nature reserve. Who cares about the rhino? So many people, so many communities and livelihoods rely on coffee production. And so many enjoy the coffee drinking. So these are just examples. I could give you many more examples, but I won't for now, okay? So what are the take-home messages so far? First, I hope you agree with me that knowledge is very key and important and crucial. Knowledge that goes beyond your area of expertise. I'm not saying your area of expertise is not good. You're all good. Together, you're the best. As a single, it's still a tiny section of knowledge. The scientific approach that you apply to your own area or field of expertise, but even beyond to anything else, is an asset, because it's what will distinguish you from politicians or policymakers that do not have a scientific approach. The perspective is going to be broad, it's going to be wide, it's going to be logical, it's going to be balanced. That will fuel your sense of responsibility, that you will feel, and it will be grounded. And that will drive your action. Any small action has a value. Don't ever think, oh, this is nothing. It doesn't matter, I won't do. No, everything, even if it's small, builds up. Because it's very easy for me. So as a single individual, I can't do anything, so I won't. If we all say that, then nobody does anything, but we all, if we all do it, yeah? So I want to start concluding. And I like this quote. It says, progress is impossible without change. And those who cannot change their mind cannot change anything. This was Professor Shaw that won a Nobel Prize. I deeply apologize for being the second white old man. Second, the first one was Svante Arrhenius. Yes. But there was a lady, a young lady, Greta. Let me make up to you very soon. I'll show you another lady, okay? Then we have gender balance in my talk, okay? Fine, good. So as a single individual, the first thing you can do is change your mind through knowledge, through learning, change your mind. This UNESCO graphics is beautiful. I really like it. Change your mind, don't change the climate, okay? And I'll finish off with this one for gender balance. It's my favorite human being on the planet. Well, perhaps both of them are. There's two, no, human being, I said, creature, I should say two creatures, two. Jane Goodall said, young people, when informed and empowered, when they realize that what they do truly makes a difference, can indeed change the world. And her life dedication is a demonstration of this, because she went beyond research. She also went on to advocacy, to talking to policymakers, and to educating the young and believing in the young. And some of you are kind of young, some of you are less young, borderline, no offense, some of you may, yeah? So anyway, I will finish here.